You're listening to The World at 8 with Lynn Mozar. The World at 8, the number one in nationalist news.
Highlights of the news today, Friday the 24th of January 2014. Woman tried to smuggle cash to Syrian terrorists in knickers. Walthamstow woman claims the police put her off reporting assault. Sham marriage a massive loophole in Britain's borders. Sweden, MPs cool towards tougher laws on political violence. Richer women enjoy better sex, at least if they're Spanish. Germany's energy revolution on verge of collapse. Zimbabwe really is going to hell. Dubai to charge Austrian woman, victim, for illegal sex. Gang rape ordered by Indian village elders. Thought for the day, a multicoloured moan. And finally, two for one, nutritional hints and Trafalgar as it should have been fought. UK news. Woman tried to smuggle cash to Syrian terrorists in knickers. Holloway, Willesden, North London. A woman accused of trying to smuggle £16,500 in her knickers to terrorists in Syria appeared in court yesterday. Naval Massad, 26, and Amal El-Wahhabi, 27, allegedly tried to take €20,000 on a flight to Istanbul, Turkey. Massad was arrested at Heathrow Airport and found to have the cash wrapped in cling film stashed in her underwear. The two women wept and hugged each other in the dock when they appeared at Westminster Magistrates Court. Walthamstow woman claims the police put her off reporting assault. A woman randomly attacked in broad daylight claims police tried to put her off reporting the offence. The 21-year-old from Walthamstow had been giving blood at the town hall and was on her way home when she was approached by five men. The men, believed to be of Asian and Turkish descent, climbed out of a black Lexus on the corner of Kenilworth Avenue in Walthamstow at just after 3:30 p.m. on Tuesday. The men were pestering the woman for her number, and after telling them she was not interested, two of the men turned violent. She was kicked in her lower back, sworn at, had a fist raised towards her face, and received death threats. The men dispersed after the woman threatened to call the police, and a father with his young child stepped in and told the men to go away. After the police arrived, two of the men had driven off in the Lexus and the other men had run off. The victim, who wishes to remain anonymous, claims the two police officers were not interested in helping her. She claims he then continued to say, "You do know that you will have to stand up in court if you report this." Just before midnight the same day, the victim received a call from the police but was told the case had been closed due to insufficient evidence. World at 8. Disgusting, but the writing on the wall, isn't it? These men were obviously Muslim and the plods have been told not to make anything of these sexual attacks. Indeed, probably the ethnicity of the plods concerned would be interesting to know. Sham marriage, a massive loophole in Britain's borders. Chief Inspector of Borders warns bogus marriage may be a growing problem, but authorities are failing to report their concerns to the Home Office. Sham marriages are a massive loophole in Britain's border controls and amount to a golden ticket into the country for immigrants, an official report has warned. John Vine, the Chief Inspector of Borders and Immigration, highlighted serious failings in the way officials are attempting to combat bogus marriages. He found evidence it could be a growing problem, but intelligence on the true pictures was lagging behind. The report said Home Office analysts said that the four main non-European nationalities involved in sham marriages were Indian, Pakistani, Bangladeshi and Nigerian. Men made up more than 8 of the 10 of the non-European half of the arrangement. They were typically trying to marry someone from the newer Eastern European states. World at 8. We've been reporting on this for years and no one really listens to it. They can still arrange sham marriages and even go so far as to arrange Asian marriages to bring more of their own tribes into the UK. It has been going on for donkey's years. European news. Sweden. MPs cool towards tougher laws on political violence. A proposal by Sweden's democracy minister seeking harsher sentences for politically motivated crimes found little support in Parliament on Tuesday during a debate about political violence. Jomshoff of the Sweden Democrats accused the Left Party and the Social Democrats of not distancing themselves enough from the violent left. He also slammed Speaker of the Riksdag Per Westerberg for participating in an anti-racism demonstration in the Stockholm suburb of Kartup in December. Christina Hoge of the Left Party chided Jomshof, saying it was rather ironic that the Sweden Democrats called for the debate when representatives of the party run around the city carrying iron pipes and support a far-right website like Avviplax. A recent report by the Swedish National Council on Crime Prevention found that the representatives from all Sweden's political parties have been subjected to threats and violence. However, the Sweden Democrats and politicians on the far left, as well as younger politicians, are more vulnerable. Richer women enjoy better sex, at least if they're Spanish. Researchers in Barcelona have taken a peek at the sexual habits of Spaniards from different economic backgrounds and concluded that money does matter, but not in the way you might think. The report by investigators at Barcelona's Public Health Agency used data from interviews carried out with 9,850 Spanish women and men. Their findings showcase the influence money can have over sexual satisfaction, but not necessarily in terms of how the wealthy can invest their money in better quality lovemaking. The level of sexual satisfaction among women from disadvantaged backgrounds or who didn't complete their primary education was 82%, 11% less than their privileged counterparts in the same 16 to 44 age bracket, ASPB researcher Dr. Gloria Perez told the local España. Dolores Ruiz, the main author of the sexual study, points out that one of the main reasons why poor women particularly find sex more stressful is because people with a lower socioeconomic status are always those who use less contraception. Once again, it's women of a lower socioeconomic status who suffer more experiences of sexual abuse, Ruiz adds. The team of researchers from Barcelona have also concluded that people with a higher socioeconomic status seem to have a better awareness of their own needs and a greater capacity for developing their sexuality in a way which they find satisfying. Although the study found the overall sexual health of Spaniards to be very high, with roughly 90% of men and women claiming to be very satisfied or quite satisfied with their intimate relationships, Ruiz has called for the implementation of new policies that close the inequality gap for women. They usually suffer more experiences of sexual abuse than men, and they claim to have less sexual gratification during their first sexual intercourse, she explains. According to the World Health Organization, sexual health is a state of physical, emotional, mental and social well-being in relation to sexuality. Germany's energy revolution on verge of collapse. Germany's energy revolution has gone sour, as have its efforts to cut carbon dioxide emissions. Chancellor Angela Merkel's Energiewende policy aims to cut greenhouse gas emissions by 40% between 1990 and 2020, mostly by closing coal-fired power plants and boosting renewable energy. Yet in 2013, coal burning soared to its highest level for more than 20 years. Then last week, Economy and Energy Minister Sigmar Gabriel said he will slash wind and solar subsidies by a third to cut rising energy bills. Subsidies for renewal currently cost German consumers €23 billion a year. Merkel is also shutting down Germany's nuclear power plants, its largest source of low-carbon energy. This means emissions, which had fallen by 27% by 2011, are now on the rise. World news. Zimbabwe really is going to hell. No, this is not some sort of Lord and Ring-style wind-up, but a genuine news report from Zimbabwe, at least according to the Daily Star, but I couldn't resist. A family turned up at their local nick in the town of Bulawayo, with a suitcase a recent tenant had left behind. The case was opened and, well, all hell broke loose. According to Bulawayo 24 News, a goblin-like creature leapt out, causing mayhem. Police officers, dumbstruck by what they were seeing, some literally jumping out of windows, such was the panic. The goblin, we'll call it that because the police report said so, apparently climbed out of a blood-filled bottle. Witnesses in the southern African state said it smelled awful and ran amok, charging at cops until a local healer was brought in to catch it. World at 8. Probably some poor little monkey or some such animal. In fact, more than likely potential bushmeat for our lot over here. I feel sorry for whatever it was and I hope it got free, but I doubt it. Goblins. Bloody mad, aren't they? And the world thinks that these people can rule themselves when clearly they cannot. Dubai to charge Austrian rape victim for illegal sex. An Austrian tourist who claimed she was raped by a policeman's son in Dubai in the United Arab Emirates has been told that she is facing jail herself for having sex outside of marriage. The 24-year-old woman reported the rape to local police, expecting they would take action against the accused, and instead found herself facing charges. And even more amazing, she claims that she was told by one of the policemen that she complained to that she could escape charges if she were prepared to marry the man that she alleged had raped her in a car during an attack in December on December the 2nd, which is a public holiday in Dubai. World at 8. Yet another highly civilised population here. Marry your rapist in another life, matey. Kill him more likely. Gang rape ordered by Indian village elders. A woman in India has been allegedly gang raped by 13 men on the order of village elders. The 20-year-old was reportedly attacked by the men in Subalpur village in West Bengal's Birbhum district. She told the police she was gang raped through the night so many times that she lost count. People from the village, men from my father's age and those who I knew as neighbours, as uncles and brothers, raped me, she said. She was accused of breaking tribal rules by having an affair with a man from a different tribe. The pair were found by the villagers, who set up a kangaroo court and levied a fine of 50,000 Indian rupees, which is £500, on the couple. The girl's family could not afford to pay the crime and, as punishment, ordered the gang rape. The following day, the family sneaked out of the village and reported the matter to the police. All of the accused, including the village headman who allegedly ordered and led the assault, have been arrested. World at 8. I give up. What is the matter with these people? It cannot be all culture with them. The trouble is we have thousands over here already with their so-called culture. And incidentally, the caste system was well in place in India amongst the Hindus well before colonialism. Thought for the day. A multicoloured moan. This is a multicoloured moan, so do excuse me. I've noticed that on the TV, on practically all the channels that originate in the UK, that the school of diversity is becoming stronger and more apparent as we watch. It's reached the stage when well-known plays and plays adapted from classic books have suddenly reached the screen as multicoloured epics. Now, as you know, my personal feelings do not run to being what is laughingly described as racist, but I do acknowledge that people are different, and viva la difference. However, this stops short in my own country of birth and domicile, England. And I cannot be the only person in this land who doesn't notice the gradual but definite recharacterization of some of our favourite figures in classic plays to a whiter shade of pale. And indeed, in some TV adaptions, the entire story has been changed to accommodate people of various and assorted colours. Now, I have no objection to a real person of colour playing a part which pertains to that colour, or fairly near it. Thus, Othello the Moor should be played by a person from Northern Africa or similar. And this is quite right and proper. However, when The Three Musketeers is advertised, most of these gentlemen, with the exception of one, look like they're straight out of the Gaza Strip or Bradford on a very dark day. Call me odd, but I really don't like this at all. I'm prepared for diversity in the workplace to an extent, and as I've been bludgeoned over the head, metaphorically speaking, for the last 30-odd years by the anti-racist thought police, I can just about take the awful changes in our eating places, pubs, shops and call centres, to say nothing of the very odd sight of the contents of our House of Lords sporting a varied multicultural clutch of dark personas amongst the pale pink and ermine. So at least four generations of our children have been raised with the idea that their country is not their own by any means, and they must put up or shut up about the almost total takeover of their educational facilities and their television viewing. It must be said, however, that this is the only country in Europe, and indeed the world, who are starting to sport more faces of colour than that of the so-called indigenous species and various white tribes of the United Kingdom. Jane Austen would be turning in her grave at the odd black and Asian or part Asian flock that's disported themselves in Pride and Prejudice over the Christmas holiday. Must our children and adults learn that England in those days, pre-Austen and post-Austen, did not have a large immigrant population of any particular ilk or culture? A smattering in port towns or the depths of London may be, but not as a matter of course. This is why in the plays of Shakespeare you have one Moor and one Jew, the rest are white or whiter than white. In most, if not all, our classic tales, the people are white or various shades of pink. Not black, not yellow, not brown, nor high yellow or khaki, but white. And this is, of course, what the TV and media made their first course of attack. And it is very clever. Over the last 40-odd years, the media have acclimatised to the massive immigration we have had to endure, and at the same pace and timing have introduced new faces, so that we will all think it is natural for a dark face to be seen every day, everywhere, all over the country. And by dark faces, I mean all people of colour or mixed race. Now, on a personal note, I don't care, especially if someone marries out, but I just don't want it to become fashionable or compulsory, which I fear is what is happening. If we didn't have massive amounts of migrants from Asia, India and China, the odd mixed race persona adds a certain amount of interest to a population, and I have no quarrel with this at all. However, when my television and films assume a darker shade of brown, I do start to get a bit edgy. Where will it all end? If the media can alter classics to suit their agenda, what is next for our impressionable youth? Already we have youngsters who cannot speak English at all, but are patois, dressing like gangsters in Harlem or worse, and being, in short, unemployable. I'm even including the EU intakes as well, which shortly will include even the sodding Turks, or rather those we don't have here already, taking over our pubs in London and doing a very good trade in sex and drugs, thank you. If you care to look very carefully at what used to be our shops, streets and towns, very little is seen of our tribes at all. And it ain't because we're all working, we ain't. It doesn't take a genius to see that we have already been taken over, in London especially. They showed on television last night a scene from a London estate. Now, I remember this estate going up years ago, and it won an award for the design, and during the last few years it sported mainly a white community. More recently, however, this has changed, and last night it was almost totally black, Asian or Arab, with the odd Eastern European thrown in for good luck. The camera does not lie, and many areas of London, although previously seen as rough and white, are now very rough and coloured, rather like my sodding TV. I was in Camberley today, at a local hospital for my better half. Now we have been visiting this place for years, when we lived in Cambers, and since we've moved, and the changes have been not so noticeable until recently, and I mean the Nepalese. Now I'm not going into reams of stuff about the Gurkhas, but I'm passing on some inside information for you. A Nepalese man with his wife and kids needed some medical treatment, and the hospital were charging him around 1,400 quid. He saw someone and told them he was an ex-Gurkha and need not pay. It turned out that he wasn't, he was just an extended member or friend, but he still insists that because he is in the UK and Nepalese, that it is all free medical treatment. This particular hospital is full of Nepalese families just sitting around waiting for family and pals. It looks like the sodding foothills in there now. One staff person laughed and said they should appeal to Joanna Lumley for her to pay, as she brought them over. Locally around parts of Surrey and Hampshire, the entire staffs of fast food places are Nepalese. Another story is that last week a pal of mine was waiting in line of traffic at the large McD's, which is situated in a large shopping park just outside Farnborough. The traffic was slow, and along the Panda crossing came a group of about 15 Nepalese walking in single file, because they're used to mountain tracks. And my pal asked her friend where they came from, and she replied, "Oh, that's the change of staff from McD's." The restaurant at the hospital is now entirely staffed by Nepalese, not the white ladies it used to have. My point being, when will it stop? When will the English jobs be really for English people, or mainly for the English? We already have generations of youngsters who not only can't speak the language, but who are apparently not worth employing, whilst people from thousands of miles away are. And why should we watch characterisations in the media which are frankly wrong? This is not right, and if being racist brings it to the fore, then so be it. And finally, two for one day, nutritional hints and Trafalgar, as it should have been fought. For those of you who watch what you eat, here's the final word on nutrition and health. It's a relief to know the truth after all those conflicting nutritional studies. The Japanese eat very little fat and suffer fewer heart attacks than Brits. The Mexicans eat a lot of fat and suffer fewer heart attacks than Brits. The Chinese drink very little red wine and suffer fewer heart attacks than Brits. The Italians drink a lot of red wine and suffer fewer heart attacks than Brits. The Germans drink a lot of beer and eat lots of sausages and fats and suffer fewer heart attacks than Brits. Conclusion: eat and drink what you like. Speaking English is apparently what kills you. And now, Trafalgar, if it were fought today. Admiral Nelson, order the signal, Hardy. Captain Hardy, aye aye, sir. Nelson, hold on, that's not what I dictated to Flags. What's the meaning of this? Hardy, sorry, sir. Nelson, reading aloud, England expects every person to do his or her duty, regardless of race, gender, sexual orientation, religious persuasion or disability. What gobbledygook is this? Hardy, Admiralty policy, I'm afraid, sir. We're an equal opportunities employer now. We had the devil's own job getting England past the censors, lest it be considered racist. Nelson, gazooks, Hardy, hand me my pipe and tobacco. Hardy, sorry, sir, all naval vessels have now been designated smoke-free working environments. Nelson, in that case, break open the rum ration. Let us splice the main brace to steel the men before battle. Hardy, the rum ration has been abolished, Admiral. It's part of the government's policy on binge drinking. Nelson, good heavens, Hardy. I suppose we'd better get on with it. Full speed ahead. Hardy, I think you'll find that's a 4-knot speed limit in the stretch of water. Nelson, damn it, man, we're on the eve of the greatest sea battle in history. We must advance and with all dispatch. Report from the crew's nest, please. Hardy, that won't be possible, sir. Nelson, what? Hardy, health and safety have closed the crow's nest, sir. No harness, and they said the rope ladders won't meet regulations. They won't let anyone up there until a proper scaffolding can be erected. Nelson, then get me the ship's carpenter without delay. Hardy, he's busy knocking up a wheelchair access to the foredeck, Admiral. Nelson, wheelchair access? I've never heard of anything so absurd. Hardy, health and safety again, sir. We have to provide a barrier-free environment for the differently abled. Nelson, differently abled? I've only one arm and one eye, and I refuse even to hear mention of the word. I didn't rise to the rank of Admiral by playing the disability card. Hardy, actually, sir, you did. The Royal Navy is underrepresented in the areas of visual impairment and limb deficiency. Nelson, whatever next? Give me full sail. The salt spray beckons. Hardy, a couple of problems there too, sir. Health and safety won't let the crew up the rigging without hard hats, and they don't want anyone breathing in too much salt. Haven't you seen the adverts? Nelson, I've never heard such infamy. Break out the cannon and tell the men to stand by to engage the enemy. Hardy, the men are a bit worried about shooting at anyone, Admiral. Nelson, what? This is mutiny. Hardy, it's not that, sir. It's just that they're afraid of being charged with murder if they actually kill anyone. There's a couple of legal aid lawyers on board, watching everyone like hawks. Nelson, then how are we going to sink the Frenchies and the Spanish? Hardy, actually, sir, we're not. Nelson, we're not? Hardy, no, sir. The French and the Spanish are our European partners now. According to the common fisheries policy, we shouldn't even be in this stretch of water. We could get hit with a claim for compensation. Nelson, but you must hate a Frenchman as you hate the devil. Hardy, I wouldn't let the ship's diversity coordinator hear you say that, sir. You'll be up on a disciplinary report. Nelson, you must consider every man an enemy who speaks ill of your king. Hardy, not any more, sir. We must be inclusive in this multicultural age. Now put on your Kevlar vest, sir. It's the rules. It could save your life. Nelson, don't tell me health and safety. Whatever happened to rum, sodomy and the lash? Hardy, as I explained, sir, rum is off the menu and there's a ban on corporal punishment. Nelson, what about sodomy? Hardy, I believe that's now legal, sir. Nelson, in that case, kiss me, Hardy. You've been listening to The World at Eight. I am Lynn Mozar, and I and the team at World at Eight and Radio Britain wish you all a very happy and a very safe weekend.